Okay, so here we go. We're going to be learning everything about accents in just one small video. So let's get started. There are a lot of resources that are available to help out with accents. There are some keyed to Athanasda, but there are also some more general accentuation resources. And I will have those in the notes beneath the video if you want to go click on some of those in some more detail. Some of this is taken directly from that top link there from Donald Mastronardi's website at UC Berkeley. So here, just a little bit of background. Diacritics, which is the entire family of breathing, accents, punctuation, everything that is not the Greek letters, were invented around 200 BCE to help non-native speakers learn Greek. Native Greek speakers did not need these marks to help them figure out how to pronounce things. They knew how to pronounce things. And for a long time in Greek culture, this was primarily an oral language, and so people weren't learning pronunciation from seeing things written. So we start to see marks in things like papyri. This is sort of the Alexandrian era. We start to really get people marking all of these pronunciations in. So here we have a papyrus that is an ancient book roll with these different things marked in. There's an acute, a circumflex, and a grave. And just to make sure we're all good on the basics here, our syllables, we have three different syllables that matter for the purposes of accentuation. So there's the last syllable, the final syllable, which we call the ultima, the ultimate syllable at the end of the word. One before that, the penultima, the almost ultima. That's our second to last syllable, and then the one that comes before that is the antepenultima. And we have this split up here for anthropos. You can see there's three syllables that matter for our purposes, and we'll use shorthand A, P, and U for those going forward. Down here we have a 16th century manuscript with the accents marked in as well. But this is much later than the papyrus that we looked at on the last slide. So let's start with our circumflex. Circumflexes can occur, they can only occur on a long syllable. And the idea being that since this is a pitch accent originally, the voice needed to have time to sort of raise and lower. And so it needs a long, the length provided by a long syllable to have that raising and lowering. So there are certain circumstances where we can have a circumflex. One time is if we have a long P, a long penultima, with a short U, a short final syllable after that. If we have an accent on the penultima in this circumstance, if there's a long P, short U, and it's accented on the P, the only kind of accent we can have is a circumflex accent. We cannot have an acute there. And then we can also have a circumflex on a long ultima. So in the abstract, this is a little bit hard to follow, but if we look at some examples here, stratioti, this is a long O followed by the short I, and this will be on a slide a little bit later, but something to remember, normally diphthongs are long vowels. This is a time when alpha iota and omicron iota, if they're at the very end of the word, will be short in a lot of circumstances. And for our purposes for now, just assume they're short. We will see some exceptions to that as we go along. So stratioti, doron, and archaios. These are all different words that have that long penultima, short ultima. And then we have some examples here of words where the accent naturally occurs on that syllable. So hadou and arete. So these accents are a circumflex on a long ultima. A grave accent can occur on the ultima, only on the ultima, and acutes can occur just about anywhere except for times where it would be an acute, but the situation it's in requires it to change to a grave, and we'll talk about those on the next slide here. An exceedingly grave situation. So if a word with an acute accent on the ultima, so if it ends with an acute accent, is followed by most other words. Almost all other words will turn that acute into a grave. The words that don't do this are if it's if we have some sort of a pause, a semicolon, a period, a sense pause there. Okay, so looking at some examples here, we have kalpos estin ha bios, and in this situation, we have what would normally be an acute on the kalpos, but it's at the end of the word, so we would expect it to change to a grav, except it's followed by an enclitic. So here, it's actually going to stay as an acute because it's followed by an enclitic. Where if we move the words around, we have the same situation if we flip habios and kalpos estin. But where we get something different is if we move kalpos habios estin. And in this situation, kalpos is no longer followed by estin, so its accent will change from an acute to a grave. The reasoning sort of behind this is that kalpos estin, that enclitic that leans onto the kalpos, is felt to sort of join into it and make it one word. And so kalpos isn't exactly the end of the word anymore. And so it retains an acute accent rather than changing to a grav. Here we have a slightly more interesting situation. So kalos estin ha anthropos, and in this situation, we have the same enclitic, so kalos stays as an acute. Then we can move things around and we get kalos with a grav accent because now it's no longer the end, part of this enclitic. Now this is an actual word end. And we get something interesting going on with our anthropos. So because this is an enclitic, this estin is going to sort of throw its accent, lean back and throw its accent onto anthropos. And so in this situation, anthropos is actually going to have two accents. Its original accent on that first alphem, and then the accent from estin. And then we have yet another situation in this third example, ha anthropos esti kalos. Here, kalos goes back to an acute accent because it's now at the end of a sentence. And anytime you have an end of a clause, some sort of a pause there, a semicolon, that raised dot, anything like that, our accent can go back to being an acute accent. And then I want to also point out that esti here has changed from estin to esti because it only takes that new, that extra new movable, if it's at the end of a sentence or if it is coming before a vowel, and we don't need that here anymore. So now let's get into some of these examples of figuring out what sort of accent and where it goes, you know, which accents can occur where. Let's get into a little bit more detail on this. So our verbs, for the most part, have a recessive accent. That means it wants to recede back on the word. And by back, I mean towards the left, towards the beginning of the word. So if our final syllable is long, the accent can only move back to the P, the penultimate there. I like to think of it that because that last syllable is long, sort of takes more out of the accent to go across that full long syllable, it can only get one syllable back. Whereas if our final syllable is short, it can go all the way back to the antepenult. So if we look at these two examples here, equino, we have that long final syllable with the O, and so our accent can only go back to the bi as opposed to the epsilon at the beginning. Where we have ekbinusi, this is a short iota at the end, so it can come back two syllables and come back to our I again. It may look like these are accented on the same syllable because they're both accented over this alpha iota syllable, but our accent is determined by how far it is from the end of the word. And so here we have a penultima accent on ekbino versus an antepenultima on ekbinusi. The one caveat I should tell you about how I think of the long accent keeping syllables from being able to go back further, keeping the accent from being able to go back further. The length of that second to the last syllable, that penultima syllable, does not matter. So if we have a short, like this iota, this short final syllable, our accent can come all the way back regardless of the fact that that oo is long. So ekbinusi, it can still come all the way back to the antepenals. Contract verbs are very similar, with the only caveat being that we need to decide our accent before we contract our verb or our vowels. So ekkale, to call someone out, we add our third person singular ending, a, and that's a long ending, it's a long syllable, and so we have a, our accent goes on the epsilon here. Now when our vowels contract, we have ekkale, and that epsilon plus the epsilon iota becomes just an a. But because our accent was on one of the syllables that was contracted there, it forms this circumflex. Again, I like to think of it as sort of, this accent is now covering both syllables. It's sort of stretching out into a circumflex accent that's covering both of these syllables. That is not linguistically sound, but this is a way that is easier for me to remember, that if we have our accent on that epsilon that gets contracted, then will result in a circumflex. A slightly more linguistically sound way to think about this is that we have a rising pitch accent on ekkale. So this rising pitch accent, generally ekkale a, the syllable after a rising accent, people think would have sort of, the pitch would have fallen back down. So we're back to sort of a neutral pitch level so we can rise again if needed. And this would just happen naturally in a normal situation, but now that these have become one syllable, we need to sort of indicate that the pitch is going to rise and then fall again over that one syllable so that we're already back down to our neutral level so the next word can begin. Whatever makes it easier for you to remember this, go with that, but the important thing is that we're going to be ending up with these circumflexes when we have an accent that is part of a contraction. On to the next kinds of accents. Let's do a little bit of quick practice with recessive accents. So below are three forms. Even though we haven't learned all of these different forms, these come from a normal non-contract verb. Go ahead and put the accents where they belong on these forms. More instances of practice here, and a couple other questions about accents. So let's go ahead, answer those as best you can, and then we'll keep moving here. Next big category of accents we're going to look at here are persistent accents. And the name is literally exactly what describes it pretty well. The accent wants to persist. It wants to stay on that same syllable, and it wants to be the same type of accent. Either of these change only if necessary. So if we look at this example here, pseudos, we have pseudus as our genitive form. And it wants to stay as a, we have a long followed by a short, right? It would like to stay a circumflex, but in this situation, we now have long, long, and it can no longer remain a circumflex, but it can stay on that syllable. So it will stay on that syllable, but it will change into an acute. If we look at pseudesin, we have a similar situation here. It would like to stay on that syllable, but it cannot be a circumflex at this point because now the syllable has become the antepenal, and we can never have a circumflex there. So it stays on that syllable, but it changes to an acute. It is more important to the accent to remain on the same syllable than to remain the same kind of accent. So it will change its type and keep its place before it will move on to a different syllable. So in pseudesin, for example, or pseudus, we could have a circumflex on that ultima, but it wants to stay on the o more than it wants to stay a circumflex. So it will stay there and just become an acute rather than being a circumflex on the last syllable. If you flowcharts help you more, this might be a way sort of to conceptualize this. So thinking of, can my accent remain on the same syllable? Yes, then we head right down to determine the type of accent. And this depends on our ultima. This is good, our ultima is going to determine what type of accent we can have. If it can't remain on the same syllable, then we take our no path, move the accent one syllable to the right, and then we determine which type of accent it's going to be. So it's a fairly straightforward, the really important part here is you have to know where the accent is in the nominative singular, because that is something you just have to memorize for each word, but then you can apply these rules and figure out where our accent will go as it changes into different cases and numbers. Moving on, we do have some special circumstances, and these ones are fun. So first and second declension nouns, these are basically our feminine alpha eta nouns, and then our masculine and neuter nouns that end in os and on. We will see some exceptions, we'll see some masculine first declension, some feminine second declension, but for the time being, this is that group of nouns. Anything in the first and second declension, if the accent is on the ultima, it will be an acute accent in our nominative, our accusative, and our vocative cases, but it will always switch to a circumflex in the genitive and the dative. So we have agathos, but agathu, and it changes into the circumflex. This is the same for singular and plural. And then our first declension nouns, we have something a little, another situation here. So our genitive plural always has a circumflex accent on the ultima, no matter what the accentuation of the other forms is. So this example we have, gnome, our accent is on the omega, normally it would want to stay there in all the different cases. This is not like agathos, where it's already on the ultima. Here, it would normally want to stay on the omega, but in our genitive plural forms, it's always going to be a circumflex over the final, our case ending there, that own ending. The reason for this is that this is a contraction from an original form that's a-own, and so the only type of accent we could have on that alpha, the accent could not go back further than that. And so we have that accent, an acute on the alpha that turns into a circumflex when it contracts. Finally, we have some weird circumstances. So the first of these is, are our enclitics. And the enclitics, as we mentioned a little bit earlier, are going to lean onto the word before them. And so in a sense, they are thought to become part of that word. We could think of this sort of as if we add an "unt" to a contraction of "not," that it becomes part of that word before for our purposes in English. So to grab our friend Kalapos Estin from before, here Estin would like to throw its accent back on Kalapos, but the syllable that accent would go on, that "os" ending, already has an accent, so there's no room for Estin to throw its accent there. That does not mean that Estin keeps an accent, though. In this situation, you can sort of think of it as throwing it onto that omicron, and there's just two acute accents, which really don't make any difference at all. So Estin loses its accent, but Kalapos, we just have that one accent, and it stays as an acute accent. In oikos, though, we have an accent on the penultimum. So here we have a circumflex on the penult, which means that when we add our enclitic estin afterwards, it leans onto oikos and it gives it that accent on the final syllable, on that omicron there. The reason it can do this is because we have a circumflex and not an acute on that previous syllable. If we look at the examples below, haponos estimakos, here, an SD has to keep its own accent. So here, SD retains an accent as opposed to putting it on ponos, so having both omicrons in ponos accented. And the reason for this is that if we go back to thinking of this accent, which started off as a pitch accent, the pitch needs to have a chance to come back down before it can rise again. And so on a three-syllable word, we have a rising accent syllable, and then it sort of settles back, it comes back down on the next syllable, and then we can come back up. So for example, anthropos, esti, there we can have an accent at the beginning, anthropos, and it can pick up two because it's had a chance to go up, come down, and then rise again. With ponos, it doesn't have time to come down. It's still falling on that second syllable, and so it can't be rising again. Oikos, because we have a circumflex, is a different situation because the circumflex has given us time to rise and fall. And so oi is a long syllable, and we have enough time to rise and fall, so then we can rise again on the second syllable. So we can have oikos with those two accents. And I will point out that in these circumstances, SD's accent, SD, estin, the accent behaves just like any other acute grave accent. And so we're gonna have a situation where it will change depending on what comes after it, if anything does. So an enclitic will take an accent on its second syllable if it has a second syllable. However, for something like ponos, tis, we just have a one syllable enclitic, tis, which we haven't learned yet, but this one syllable can't, it has nowhere to pick up this accent. It can't have an accent on the second syllable it doesn't have. And so here it just is unaccented. And this is different than tis is related to a word that we have seen, which is our word, our question word for why. So here we have ti uk ages, and you'll notice that this one does have an accent. When ti or tis, are accented up in the front of the sentence and they have this acute accent, then we know it's a question word, as opposed to when we have the unaccented or the enclitic versions. And those ones are going to be an indefinite pronoun, which is something we'll learn about later on. And there's one last one last category. So for the most part, Greek words all have an accent, or they have a reason they don't have an accent. They are leaning onto something else, or they, you know, they're part of a word unit that has an accent. And this is exactly what's going on with our proclitics. So u, uk, uch, and our articles, ha, hey, hoi, hi. These do not have accents because the article is felt to sort of be so closely a part of the word it goes with that it doesn't need its own accent. This accent on anthropos is fine. We have enough accents there for ha anthropos. So it doesn't need its own accent. And so these proclitics, they lean forward as opposed to our enclitics, which lean back onto the word. And then one last reminder, we, most diphthongs are long, but there are certain circumstances where alpha iota and omicron iota at the end of words will be short. And we've seen some of these throughout this tutorial. I just want to remind you about that. For the time being, assume that if a word ends with alpha iota or omicron iota, that is a short syllable. Anywhere else in the word, it's long. There will be some exceptions to this, but we will deal with those when we get to them. There are a lot of little minor exceptions to these rules, but those are things that we will deal with as we get to them. This should get you pretty much through most of your questions about accentuation. There are a few more questions for you to try to do on your own, And then if you have any additional questions, obviously there are these resources below that are great resources to use, but you can always come talk to me and we can work through some more accentuation.